We got Margarita Santelier here in town, Pat Sullivan from Forest Hills, Maureen down by the farmland. Mary Grimmie is in the cornfield. That is lovely. Kathy is visiting us here from, she's here in Kendall. John is up in Port Orange. Nick is out by the airport. Dennis is in Port St. Lucie. Melissa is near the golf course down in Kendall. Donald Grimmie is out in Tampa. Ray Rolden is in New York. I always get this wrong. Why am I blanking? It's Fort Washington. No, Washington Heights. Washington Heights. There we go. Serge Cruz is here. We've got Tony Lee in Miami Lakes, Roy Martin from Bellingham, Washington, Hal and Linda from Port Orange, and Kay Schweitzer from Port Orange as well. Okay, and we've got John Anderson is here as well, and his wife, Angela. All right, and let's see what we've got then. Serge, at this point, it is 11 o'clock. Do you want to go ahead and start?
Yes. Okay, let's get started. So good morning, everyone. All Souls voluntarily belongs to other congregations, to the UUA, the Unitarian Universal Association. So right now, the UUA is asking congregations to accept the eighth principle as a statement about what we think and believe about racism. We've discussed it on a service this summer. We sent it out a number of times in emails that the doc sent out, that Ken sent out as well. He's also included the other seven principles and the six sources with the bulletin from this morning. As a reminder, this eighth principle is not anything, a mandatory creed or anything. It's not like it's not a dogma that has to be accepted. It just gives us like a sense of what the majority of the people at All Souls agree with if we vote to accept it. And there you have the eighth principle, and I'll just read it pretty quickly. We, the member congregations of the Unitarian Universalist Association, covenant, affirm and promote journeying towards spiritual wholeness by working to build a diverse, multicultural, beloved community by our actions that accountably dismantle racism and other oppressions in ourselves and our institutions. So we just need to call a quorum. So is there a quorum to vote on this?
Yes, there is. We have to have 20% of D's and D, of M's and DM's on the list. We have over that, we have a quorum established.
Excellent. Is there a motion to accept?
Somebody needs to move that we accept the eighth principle.
I move to accept.
I accept.
Three. Great. Great. Thank you. Any discussions about the eighth principle?
No.
Let's do it.
Hear you. All in favor?
Aye.
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 All against? All right. Looks like we have everyone's in favor.
100%. 100%.
One of the things I want to share with you all to show you how different we are as a group. Several of the congregations have gotten in arguments about how you define the word principle. I kid you not. They said, principle means this, the principle means that. And I said, we're trying to deal with, it just amazes me how people, anyway, you got the idea that we're trying to be a multicultural environment. And Carol Ryder said something a long time ago, which I thought was brilliant. She said, it's too bad when you get a birth certificate, you don't get your DNA printout. It's attached to it that can't be separated, because a lot of people are a lot more than what they think they are. And any of you who've done your DNA know that. And I've shared with you the first two classes we have when I teach at Miami-Dade is we ask people to voluntarily share their DNA if they would, or their great, 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 great parents, where they came from. And almost everybody does. And we have anywhere from a minimum of 36 to a maximum of 44 countries represented. every semester. So in all of these countries, there are different classes, different kinds of racism, and it seems to be endemic with our species. Just because it's endemic doesn't mean we can't work against it and try to make a beloved community of everybody. All right, having said that, we welcome again, Barbara Young has joined us. We have a lighting of the memorial candle. I wish to take a special time out to remember a very, very sad statistic this week. 1 in 500 Americans have lost their lives to COVID. 1 in 500. That is an astounding figure considering it is 2021. So for all of the ones who have passed and their families that are still wrestling with what this means, we remember them all. A moment of silence. Amen. I ask you to join with me in a call to worship. We welcome Danny from New York as well. If you would read the indented part and ask everybody to mute up if you read it at home, if we would read this responsively. We are people of all ages who enter this space. We come together in hope. We come together in harmony. We share our growth and our aspirations. We come together in wonder. We share our losses and our disappointments. We come together in sorrow. We share our concern and our compassion. We come together in love. We come to this place bringing our doubts and our faith. We come together as seekers. We sing and pray and listen. We speak and read and dream. We mourn and celebrate and meditate. We strive for justice and for mercy. We come together in worship. And from an old, old prayer from long ago, from Patrick of Ireland. If you would, for those of you who wish, if we would read this together, may the way of the divine pilot us. May the healing of the divine preserve us. May the wisdom of the divine instruct us. May the strength of the divine protect us. May the love of the divine direct and defend us. Amen. Suggested that, Ray Roland suggested that as a way of a song that helped him at all times, and we share the lyrics of that as well. The next reading is talk about pain and suffering. Angie Hill is going to read this. It's taken from the book of Genesis. Several of you know the story. If you would, Angie.
But Sarah saw the son of Hagar, the Egyptian, whom she had borne to Abraham, playing with her son Isaac. So she said to Abraham, "Cast out this slave woman with her son, for the son of this slave woman shall not inherit along with my son, Isaac." So Abraham rose early in the morning and took bread and a skin of water and gave it to Hagar, putting it on her shoulder along with the child, and sent her away. And she departed and wandered about in the wilderness of Beersheba. When the water in the skin was gone, she cast the child under one of the bushes. Then she went and sat down opposite him a good way off, about the distance of a bow shot. For she said, "Do not let me look on the death of the child." And as she sat opposite him, she lifted up her voice and wept.
Very, very old, old story from the book of Genesis. And again, for those of you who wish, if we would read this responsively, if you would read the indented part, and please stay muted. I share with you the agony of your grief. The anguish of your heart finds echo in my own. I know I cannot enter all you feel, nor bear with you the burden of your pain. But I can offer what my love does gift: the strength of caring, the warmth of one who seeks to understand, the silent, storm-swept barrenness of so great a loss. This I do in quiet ways, that on your lonely path, you may not walk alone. Amen, shalom, salim, halakim, blessed be, peace. Grant us, we ask, to speak, to hear, and to learn, so that our fears may be banished, our minds become enlightened, our faith be increased, our steps directed towards you. Amen. No matter how you cut it, the story of Hagar is just plain wretched. There are all kinds of attempts of later editors to somewhat make this palatable. The reality is Hagar is a poor woman. Some said she was a princess. The bottom line is she gets stuck as being a servant to Abraham and his wife, Sarah. The bottom line is Sarah can't have children. So we have the first surrogacy that we've seen ever recorded in Holy Scripture in the book of Genesis. So Hagar gives birth, and everybody forgets this. This was the first born, you might say. His name was Ishmael. And if you've ever read Moby Dick, it's interesting. What's the very first phrase of Moby Dick? Call me Ishmael. And Ishmael minds his own business. He does the right thing. He grows up. And then somewhere along the line, as it would have it, Sarah conceives, and this will produce tension between Sarah and Hagar. Why? Because you have two males and you have the inheritance issue. And the inheritance issue in the olden time was the first son gets it all. And by the way, it was not only olden times, up into the 19th century. I'm sure all of you, if you've studied anything about Northern European, and I'm sure it's probably true for Southern European history, remember it well, the first son gets everything. They ship the second son off to the military. The third son goes into the clergy. And then what do you do with the rest? If you want to know where the conquistadors came from, take a look at Spain. And what do you do in fourth, fifth, and sixth sons? And you don't know what to do with them. And they're 18, 19, and 20. There's nothing left. Same thing goes back. The first son gets everything. And who's the first son by birthright? Ishmael. So after the baby is born, Sarah looks at this and absolutely has a hissy fit and tells Abraham, out she goes. Abraham, that fine paragon of male virtue and steadfast ethics, takes the woman with one skein of water, a loaf of bread, how generous, sticks them in the desert, says goodbye, I wish you well, and that's it. What a paragon of moral ethics that was. Then there are all other kinds of interventions, but the bottom line is the water runs out. They almost die. And as luck would have it, you may call it divine intervention, whatever you wish, they are saved, water presents, they get some bread, and they go on. I don't buy how they're saved, but one of the things that escapes everybody in all of this is what happens to Ishmael. There is a very interesting sentence that nobody ever picks up for all those Bible readers. Abraham finally dies. And guess who buries him? And the text says, Ishmael joined Isaac in burying their father. Now, I don't know about you. If some old man tossed me out in the desert to die, I'm not going to go back and bury him nicely. But no, Ishmael, with great love and respects, goes back also and buries his father with his half-brother. Ishmael will go on to have a progenitor of tribes and stuff. And by the way, if you've ever read any of this, if you ever took a course in Genesis, guess who will marry one of Ishmael's great-great-granddaughters? Esau, Jacob's twin brother, will marry one of Ishmael's great-granddaughters. Yes, if you study the bloodlines in Genesis, Ishmael's family are a nice group. They go on to do nice things. Not so much with the other. It is the great first telenovela. The story is tragic. You kick a woman out, kick her son out. You give them some bread and some water and hope that that's going. Did Hagar, when she was growing up, ever think that she was going to be apprenticed to and made a slave to a family? No, nobody thinks that when they grow up. Did Ishmael, at the age of 12 or so, think that out of nowhere, he's going to be tossed out on his own? There was nothing anywhere to prepare anybody for this. You see where I'm going for this. Things happen. They happen. I don't know if you've heard of this person. I never heard about him until I read about him in a New York Times book review a couple of weeks ago. His name is Jan Gru. I'm sure I'm pronouncing that wrong. He's Norwegian. He was diagnosed as a child with a rare form of spinal muscular atrophy, which means all of his bones, his spine, his legs, and his arms are all twisted like a pretzel. The world, he says, perceives a body with frail arms, legs locked into certain angles. The world sees a thin body in a large, bulky wheelchair. He says, navigating in a wheelchair in an airport is bizarre. Take a look at how people look at you when you're in a wheelchair in an airport, when your legs are all tied up in a bundle and you all look like a pretzel. Did he ask for any of that as he popped out of the womb? No, of course he didn't. Some of you may have heard of Venus Williams. One of the things Venus Williams had to do was drop out of a major tennis match because she wiped out her leg. But I bet you don't know that Venus Williams suddenly found herself with an autoimmune system, an autoimmune disease that is going to impact the rest of her life, and there's no getting around it, and there's no curing it. And it caused and triggered a major mental health crisis with her. She shared that on the front page of the New York Times, and everybody was shocked. What happens? And each of you, think of, we saw the story of the Haitians the other day. Did any of those Haitians, when they were born, ever think that they were going to have to leave their country? Did anybody ever, when they were born in Haiti, ever think they're going to wind up on the Rio Grande and then get attacked by a bunch of people on horses and then shipped off in planes and back again? Did anybody prepare them for that? Did anybody give them survival skills? Did anybody do any of that stuff? Now, unless we're talking about Jan Gru from Norway or Venus Williams, the tennis star, or Haitians from another country, each of you has your own story. And for better or worse, I know most of you and I know your stories. Nobody here that I know has escaped tragedy. Nobody here has escaped upset. Nobody here has escaped disease. Nobody here has escaped any of that. To live, unfortunately, is to know stuff. Stuff. I was talking to one of our members the other day, and I said, you know, when you've lived longer than 3/4 of a century, you know, just saying that is freaky. When you live longer than 3/4 of a century, and you've pastored a lot of churches, three of them that were in the old days really big, you know a lot of people. And one of the things that I found was fascinating was the story of Leave It to Beaver and the Nelson kids and stuff may have been cool on TV in the 50s as a template of the American family. I've never met that family. Every family I have met, the kids are a mess. The family, maybe mess is the wrong word. I'm being overdramatic. Every family has issue with their kids and kids with their parents. Every family has issues with divorce. Every family has issues with mental illness. Every family has issues with addiction. I've never met the perfect family. The perfect family doesn't exist except on TV. Everybody has been through major issues. Families have been, that's the way it is, folks. It's not sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows morning, noon, and night. The eternal question is, why is pain and suffering? I remember Hobbes was famous to write, "The life of man is solitary, poor, nasty, brutish, and short." Well, that's a bit too much for me because we do have joy. But the reality is nobody likes to be realistic, especially in our society. Reality is fate happens, bad stuff happens, random stuff happens, things happen. Now, I know I've mentioned this before, but it's one of those kinds of things that I have not ever gotten out of my mind. On Old Cutler Road, beyond the light where the Presbyterian Episcopal Church is, a guy had a flat tire with his truck. He calls his best friend. They're changing the flat tire, and a drunk ran through the red light and killed both of them. Now, how do I know that? Because the funeral director called me and said, Kenneth, I have a family that has had a horrific accident with their eldest son, and they are so mad, they don't know what to do, but they need a clergyman to conduct the funeral. And they don't said, and he said, quote, they don't want any of the traditional crap either. So I thought I'd better call you. How do you even begin to explain that your son, who's trying to help somebody, both of them get hit by a drunk driver who was perfectly fine, thank you, in another truck? When you've done as many funerals as I have, you find that this is not unusual. It's not unusual. A quote from last week. The world is not as good as we want it to be. We are not as good as we want to be. Individual behavior is greatly influenced by things outside, oftentimes, of an individual's control. Many things that happen to us are historical. Events in our past, events in the past of an individual's family, customs of a culture that is built up through history and can often be mean and harsh. These things affect humanity as a group as well as individuals. Be glad you're not living in Afghanistan right now. If we want to make that real. So some observations. And I realize, by the way, that I say some observations, these are simply observations, but there's an old thing in 12-step programs. You must qualify. Do I qualify to give some observations? I did not pop out of the womb saying, ooh, you know what I need to do is get a virus in my heart and decide to be one of the first ones to have a transplant when nobody knew exactly what they were doing. Those of you from Port Orange remember, some of you saw the picture of me on Facebook. 1 year, 6 months after the transplant, my face was out to here and my neck went from a size 15 to an 18. Yes, it was a glorious time. And then my hair fell out. And my wife says, quit complaining about your hair. Would you rather have hair and be in an urn? Or do you just the way you are and annoy everybody? Moving along. I didn't pop out of the womb saying, ooh, I have an absolute love of scotch, especially the 12-year-old kind, or vodka martinis, which would obviously cause me enormous problems later on. Nobody pops out of the womb saying, wee-ha, I want to get sick or I want to get an addiction. So I think I qualify to talk about some of the nasties of life, not only personally, but having been working with people since 1970 professionally, we're going to go through the same kinds of crap. Yes, I know we're not supposed to say that word in sermons. The reality is, and this is just a personal opinion, I have no answer as to why there is pain and suffering. Oh, I've heard all kinds of answers, but I have not found any of them suitable. I have come to that point in life that there are some questions which are good questions, but there are, for me anyway, there are no suitable answers. And I will not offend anybody to give you a bunch of pious answers when I personally don't believe them. Number two, our society has not helped us. You know, our society is almost like that Dr. Pangloss character in Voltaire's Candide. All is for the best, and this the best of all possible worlds. You know, and when something goes wrong, it's not quite right. Scott Peck, I'm going to absolutely mess this up in a paraphrase. He said, the problem in the United States is you and I are taught that life always must be sunshine, lollipops, and rainbows, unicorns, everywhere, everything is nice. And when that little thing that comes along that upsets it all, that's abnormal. He said, that's simply not true. Life is hard. Things happen. People get sick. People have things happen to them. And when we have moments of joy for a lot of people, that's the one that's abnormal. We've got it all backwards. He said this obsessive optimism in the face of harsh reality is not helpful to us. It does not prepare us for when fate and bad things happen. So I don't think their answers, personal observation. I don't think our society has helped us grow up to face reality. And some other observations. Number three, belief that God is punishing us. I've never understood that. Why would you worship a God who you believe is good, all creating and all knowing? Why would you worship a God like this, who obviously had to know what he was creating or she was creating, and then says we screw up and then gets mad and punishes us? Now, if you want to believe in a God like that, that's fine, but I think that's kind of counterproductive. Why would you want to believe in a God that's going to punish you for something they created to begin with? That makes no sense to me. By the way, I do believe in God, but just not that definition of God. So the idea that God is punishing us, I don't find helpful at all. That just makes it worse. So what do you do with all of this? You know, and I know, bad things happen. So what do you do? And I think we have three choices. We have three choices. Number one, blame yourself. That's a goodie. I can't tell you how many people I've had to work with who blame themselves for everything that went wrong. Yes, sometimes we make up mistakes. Sometimes you mess up. So fix it. I can't fix it. Kathy can't fix it. Pat can't fix it. But you have the tools to fix it. You do. And you'd be amazed at how many people give you hints. I know I've said this before. When I had the alcohol issue, the major problem, who was the one person who gave me the suggestion? He's sitting right here. And he said, go like the rest of us. And so I hiked myself off to what I euphemistically call Camp Happy. It was not happy, but it needed to be done. You can fix yourself and you can find people that will work with you. So if you want to blame yourself, be miserable, be rotten, and afflict all, and you want to do the flagellation like the monks did and beat yourself, fine. That's not going to fix anything, folks. It'll scar you up mentally, emotionally, and physically, but it's not going to fix the situation. It's not going to heal. Blaming others, that's a good one too. Blaming others. You can pull what some people we have done, if you've seen since the last election has been won and lost. You can load yourself resentment, grievance, anger, and depression, and blame everybody else. Does that heal anything? You may think it does by yelling, screaming, blaming, pointing the finger, loaded with grievance and self-righteous indignation. Has that ever healed anything? Has that ever really healed anything? Or you can take an opposite approach and get about looking at life the way it really is and tackling that. Jan Grew went on, catch this, looking like a pretzel and suffering incredible, but he's alive and well. He's married and has a child, got a PhD. He holds a doctorate in linguistics and teaches at the University of Oslo, is considered a brilliant teacher. And he writes extensively about how you deal with pain and issues. Rather than getting angry and looking inward, he worked at it and looked outward. Venus Williams was so surprised by the mental anguish and illness that she faced when she found that she had the autoimmune disease. She now has started, listen to this, listen to what she's done. I have partnered with the therapy service BetterHelp and the Women's Tennis Association. We are now providing $2 million towards free therapy to anybody who signs up. Neither of these individuals are loaded with resentment, grievance, anger, and yelling at everybody or themselves. What did they do? They went out to help others. What an interesting concept. You get your act together, you go teach, you write, you help. Venus shut up and gave $2 million to help found free therapy for anybody who wants it. Wow. Absolutely wow. Now, some suggestions I had. Find what grounds you. This always surprises everybody. I look at what grounds me. Actually, I like the life of Jesus. I do not like any of the doctrines or dogmas about Jesus. They ruin it for me. But when I look at how this Galilean peasant grows up in absolutely impoverished conditions and does what? He hikes himself down to a very strange place near outside of Jerusalem in the Jordan River, which is polluted. It was always polluted back then too. And he meets this absolutely weird guy, John the Baptist, who was dressed in camel hair and looked like some guy with dreadlocks from something out of God knows where, gets himself baptized and decides to follow this esoteric character and then goes back to the Galilee. And what does he do? He works with the poor, not with the wealthy, not with the power movers, not so he can be an influencer on MTV or TV, no. He works with those who have no credentials, no portfolio, and no money. He works with the poor and women and children and Samaritans and tax collectors and everybody else under the sun. He does it. Poor as dirt. And he does it. For what? For others. I look at Jewish scriptures. I am fascinated by those texts that we don't read enough of. The suffering servant. Those who go out and help others when they are afflicted. Remember that famous suffering servant? He had an affliction and we could not look at him. And the suffering servant goes out and helps others. Remember what Jesus said? Matthew's gospel has this very interesting thing. When did we see you? And it goes on and on and on, and they're trying to figure out when did we see you? And he said, you saw me when you clothed the naked, you gave food to the poor, you visited the sick. That's when you saw me. No angels and pie in the sky. No, when you went out and did things with people. So I see Jewish scripture and I see the life of Jesus. Then I discovered some Sufi poetry. I discovered Zoroaster's ethics. Here's one for you. I hope you all memorize this. Zoroaster had this great complex idea of ethics. You ready for this? Good thoughts, good words, good deeds. That's it, folks. Can you improve upon that? Good thoughts, good words, good deeds. And then I discovered some of Gandhi's thoughts. And I thought, you know, that kind of made sense. During World War II, a writer had visited Gandhi in ravaged India. And he said, you have in your little hut one picture. It's a picture of Jesus. Why? You're not a Christian. And Gandhi said, I am a Christian. I am a Jew. I'm a Hindu, I'm a Muslim, I'm them all. I began to think about that, and I began to think, what grounds me? The life of Jesus, Sufi poetry, Zoroastrian thoughts, that famous definition of God, of Brahman, from the Bhagavad Gita. All of those, in their own ways, have added to the tapestry of my life. Whatever grounds you have to pick. Each of you has a way that you journey through life and you have to find what grounds you. That is what's going to get you through. And it better be good, because if it's no good, get rid of it. When stuff gets bad as it gets bad, often what grounds you? That is your homework. That's your ongoing homework. Number two, forget the solitary nonsense. That's another thing that we grew up in this country. The great individual from the Wild West. I told you last Sunday, last time we gathered, those who are individual in the Wild West died very painfully and by themselves. You lived in the Wild West on your own, you're going to get eaten, shot, or died quickly. You needed people to live. So if you think you can do it alone, good luck. When we come home and find your skeleton, we'll talk about you. We'll remember you. You can't do it alone, folks. You need to find friends, real friends. Number three, you need to be gathered in a community. You don't like All Souls? Fine. Find a community that actually accepts you for who you are. Period. No footnotes. Accepts you for who and what you are. Have you ever taken a look at this group? I mean, seriously, have you ever really looked at what makes us up? You want to talk about a tapestry of, oh my soul, what a different group we are. I mean, imagine Maureen, Donald Grimmie, you guys haven't met Hal yet, Barbara Young, and I don't know, Kathy and me in the same room together. Holy mackerel. That's got to be one of the funniest collections of people ever. Then you throw it, you guys haven't met Gail and Tom personally. Chris Diaz, would you look at this group? It's insane. A variety of opinions, ideas, and thoughts and backgrounds. I mean, talk about a pizza, a smorgasbord. I mean, my heavens. And that's the kind of stuff that makes a real community. That's the kind of stuff that when you're going through it, people will understand because they've been there too. So find what grounds you. Forget the solitary stuff. Gather it in a community. Hold your friends close. Care for your friends. Love your friends. Remember, because they're not going to be around. And I want to hear you say, I should have loved them more. It's too late. And finally, honor the past. Joy what you can in the present. And by God, embrace the future, knowing that you've grounded yourself, you've got friends, you've got community, and you've got people who love you, not just when the good time comes, but when all those bad times hit as well. Maureen sent out something yesterday. Yet again, somebody where she works has been unvaccinated and they died and they left families. And somebody else died again right after that. And so what does Maureen do? She shares it with us, which is what you're supposed to do. And she got responses. So ground yourselves. That's your job. That is your eternal homework. Love one another. Accept one another. Community with one another. And that's what gets us through. So we can smile again. Smile some more. Listen to some music. Worship some more. Hold hands and look to the future. Amen. There is a scene in that movie where there's a little child. I'm going to cry. And the mother's singing to the child's spirit of life. If anybody ever wants us to start singing that regularly, have it after the share, I would be glad to include that. We offer every time we gather, not holy mysteries, not sacred mysteries, but what we call the Jesus meal. Throughout his ministry, he met with all kinds of people. They were called publicans and sinners. That would be all of us. Men, women, children, different backgrounds. And he broke bread. No holy mysteries, no sacred rites. Just simply took bread, simple bread, and watered down wine. And that's what you did. He got that from his Jewish ancestors, who got it from the Canaanites, who got it from way, way before then, when bread first started making its appearance about 10,000 years ago as a common staple in then Turkey and then down through what we now call the Levant. So you offered simple bread and simple wine as an act of friendship, an act of affirmation. At All Souls, when we gathered in person and when we gathered at rallies, once we have a chance to do that too, we ask people who wish to come forward to take some bread and to dip it into some wine, but then we don't stop there. We ask others for whom this does not work to come forward, And I'm not sure when and how we got these words, but we did. We borrowed them from, of all things, Winnie the Pooh and another writing. And I'll ask you at home to mute up and to repeat after me. Promise me you'll remember. You are braver than you believe, stronger than you seem, smarter than you think. God didn't promise days without pain, laughter without sorrows, sun without rain. But the divine did promise strength for the day, comfort for the tears, and light for the way. Amen. Now, for those of you who are new here and have not seen this, this will seem strange. We stole something. We didn't borrow, we absolutely stole it. NA and AA has this thing at the end that if you have something bothering you, before you leave, you pick up a black chip. That is your job to work on that till you come to the next meeting. Somewhere early on, we decided to do this, and I don't remember how, it was 16 years ago. And so we ask if anybody has a black chip to return. Does anybody have? And if you do, just show it. Just lift it up and show that you've worked on what you need to work on. If you need black chips, by all means, email me and I will send you bunches. So you will not be without them. Does anybody need to pick up a black chip today? Anybody need to pick one up? Anybody need to pick one up? A concluding prayer. May the blessings of God be upon us in this hour and in the days to come, that we may seek the truth more devotedly, that we may think more independently, that we may reflect more searchingly, that we may know ourselves more completely, that we may forgive more quickly, may pray more thoughtfully, may act more courageously, and we may live more nobly. We have a song, and then afterwards, please stay for a blessing and a chance to say goodbye and welcome everybody before we go. Louis Armstrong, A Nice Way to End.
I can only speak for myself, but I don't hear anything.
No, I'm texting Margarita now. Let's wait and see. There's a glitch. Let's see what happened.
I see.
No, I don't know why it's not playing because it shows that it's recording. It's got the audio. Let me stop this. Hold on.
It's playing now. It started playing just when you stopped it, just before you stopped it.
Let me try that again. Give me a second. Because it had on share audio. That happens.
Okay.
Hear it?
What a wonderful world.
I hear it.
Okay. I see skies of blue. Clouds of white, bright blessed days, dark sacred nights, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world. The colors of the rainbow, so pretty in the skies, also on the faces of people going by. I see friends shaking hands, saying, how do you do? They're really saying, I love you. I hear babies crying. I watch them grow. They'll learn much more than I'll ever know. And I think to myself, what a wonderful world. Yes, I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Please stay for a moment. A blessing, and please stay for a moment afterwards. From the Irish, now may the road rise to meet you. May the wind be always at your back. May the sun shine warm upon your face. May the rains fall softly upon your fields. And from the Hindus, and when we meet again, may the divine in me greet and embrace the divine in you. Amen.